This podcast is recorded on stolen and unceded Aboriginal land.
We acknowledge the First Nations and elders of this country and join their calls for justice. Always was, always will be Aboriginal land.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter. Guess who else died and came back? Or like wasn't there for a while and then came back, like Jesus. Me.
You?
I'm back on the show. I'm kind of like Jesus. Oh, God. Do you think we have any listeners who are offended by blasphemy? I don't think so. You're a co-host. You say stuff like, God sucks.
They're all godless heathens. Yeah, that's true. Mm. Happy Easter. Happy Comedy Festival, everybody. The Melbourne Comedy Festival has kicked off. Have you watched my gala spot? And if so, how many times?
I'm not in that. You said I'm featured in your new show, but am I featured in your gala?
No.
Spot?
No, you did not get a run.
Why would I?
Boring. For my gala spot, I did a little routine about a hilarious post from the US Embassy last year. I don't know if we talked about it on the show. Do you remember the US Embassy posted this list of like stupid slang, their guide to showing slang? You remember the story? Right. I've got a very funny routine about that. Hanging shit on them. God, America sucks. We can't take them seriously. Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, Seppos, they're the worst. Yeah.
Do that, Seppos. I use the term Seppos. It's so good. Seppos is so good. Recorded that on Wednesday last week. Okay. The next morning, I wake up. This is before it's even gone on television. The next morning, I wake up, and on Instagram and Twitter, I have a new follower, the US Embassy to Australia.
Oh. Wait, so someone has – there were spies.
Spies? American spies, yes.
Who reported your comedy bit to the US Embassy. That's quite funny. Wow. Do you think they're listening right now?
Almost certainly. I think Pine Gaff is focused mainly on the Serious Danger podcast. Yes.
Okay, no. If you guys are listening, can you stop it?
Stop it, guys.
And you know exactly what I mean.
You know all what? Of it. Hey.
That's enough.
Come on. It's Easter, guys.
From us. For me.
The fact that Anthony Albanese would even suggest, even as a brain fart, maybe I could work with the Greens, shows the disdain that Anthony Albanese and the Labor Party hold Christians in.
We're stuck with the hosts of Chapo Shithouse podcast.
Serious Danger to Australia.
This is for you. This is for you, America. This is Serious Danger, a podcast about green politics in Australia. This is an unofficial Greens Party podcast. It is made possible with the help of the Green Institute and produced by Michael the Griff Griffin, Tom Ballard here on Wurundjeri and Boonwurrung country in the Kulin Nation. And yes, Emerald is back, baby.
I'm back. I'm actually recording on Bunjalung country at home. Well, I'm not at home. I'm staying with some friends in Byron. And so I'm looking directly at them in their pool as we record, and I'm just stuck indoors talking to you. So that's great. That's how much I love you and I love this show.
Happy Easter, everyone. It's lovely to have you back. Big thanks to Jack Toohey. I loved how we had Jack Toohey on, you know, this viral, cool political content creator on the week that Meta decides to limit all political content and fuck our reach everywhere.
Again, I mean, they know that we hold a lot of sway within the US Embassy and you know, the state of that superpower. And you have to wonder if there's something going on there.
I'm so sick of being shadow banned and silenced.
Yeah.
I hope you're having a good Easter and a long weekend, whatever you're doing. If you're able to have some time off, that would be great. This week, we are looking at the politics and possibilities of Labor and the Greens teaming up and joining forces. What? Could it be?
The Green Elition.
And we're going to be joined by Reem Borrows from the Palestine Australia Relief and Action Organisation, PARA, to discuss what Australia is and isn't doing to help Palestinian refugees and migrants, people who have come here, you know, fleeing Israel's assault on Gaza, and a general check-in on the fight for free Palestine more generally. Fantastic to have Reem joining us on the show.
Yes.
We should say thanks to our new patrons.
New patrons, Kobe and Kate. Patreon still not censoring our political content. So, you know, if you want the good stuff, it's all over there. It's only $3 a month to become a patron and support the show. Helps pay Mike's wages and helps us do fun stuff. We have a Patreon episode, sorry, probably because of me and because I've been out of action. It's slightly delayed, but it is coming. There is bonus content there. There's heaps of cool stuff. We're doing another Inside the Greens. And I hear it. I feel like it has some interesting tie-ins into the current state of Tasmanian politics. So interesting to learn from history. Can't wait for my lesson. My lesson and yours, dear listener.
It's a real Dr. Doolittle thing, isn't it, when I'm just educating you in the ways of the Greens.
Dr. Doolittle, isn't that, what, am I an animal? What are you saying?
Am I thinking of Dr. Doolittle? What am I thinking of? Dr. Henry
Tom's
Higgins.
Like, only I can speak to Emerald. I speak her language.
I didn't mean Dr.
Wow, that's
Doolittle.
Really misogynistic, actually.
I meant Henry
really
Higgins
up.
From My Fair Lady.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Wow. Hey, yeah, we're doing live shows. Yeah, we've banged on about these because we love doing live shows and you're very nice to buy tickets to them, everyone. I think there's less than 30 tickets left to our show in Nam, Melbourne next weekend, Saturday, April the 6th at 1:30 p.m. Beautiful Comedy Republic. Melbourne is alive with the spirit of laughter and joy.
Melbourne
at the moment.
Is alive with the sound of danger.
There you go. There, it was very good. We've announced our special guest is OSMAN FARUQI. We're finally getting him on the show. He's going to join us live on stage. It's happening at 1:30 p.m. Yes, very few tickets left for that one. Mm. And Meanjin Brisbane, holy shit, you sold out our first show already.
What the heck?
Our 2 p.m. show.
How did you guys do that?
It's very kind. Crazy. Thank you, Greensland. We've added an extra show, an early one at 12 p.m. The links to buy tickets for that one are in the show notes for this episode. If you bought tickets for the 2 p.m. show and you want a Serious Danger double feature, you want all Serious Danger all the time, you should have received an email this week from the good people at Good Chat Comedy Club giving you a discount code to get $5 off tickets for that earlier show. We appreciate you buying tickets for the first one. If you want to come to both, it's a little bit cheaper for you.
We'll do the exact same show, but in between them, you'll have an opportunity to provide feedback and we'll workshop it and, you know, come to a consensus decision on how we should present that material. And then you'll get to see the product of that in the second show.
I did not agree to this.
No, they'll be different, guys. So you should come to both. And if you haven't bought tickets to either yet, especially if you're my friend and you're listening to this, you know how sad and disappointed I'll be if you haven't got tickets yet. So get tickets to the second fucking shows. Who knows? It could sell out as well. So hurry up.
Big thanks to the Griff who posted on our Patreon saying, hey, sorry, there isn't a Patreon app yet. This week's a little bit delayed. But here's Tom's new stand-up special for free on YouTube. Is that, I don't know if that's like, does that make up for it? Well, it's very nice. That's very nice of him to do. I did release it this week. I'd love people to watch it if they get a chance. It's totally free. It's on the 800 Pound Gorilla Media channel. It is I. It's my show from last year. They got nominated for an award. It lost. But it's me yelling about how Australia can't change and how the monarchy sucks and about my gay Aboriginal 26-year-old professional circus acrobat boyfriend, and it's fun for the whole family.
Can't shut up about him, can you? Why don't you marry him?
We're not allowed, okay? It's still a crime.
It's
links to what's his special are in the show notes. Thank you.
Before we get into the meat of the show, there are some things that have been happening that maybe we'll come back to. I think particularly the Labor government rushing through or attempting to rush through these new immigration powers, I think we'll probably be coming back. That's now been referred to a committee. Is that right? Senate committee, the legislation.
I think so. So
it'll come back and we can discuss it further then.
Yes. Again, I haven't read into it too much. There has been a lot going on, but holy shit, the glimmers of details, basically Labor wanting Trump-like powers to basically say you can't come here if you're from this country and striking things off, really, really rushed legislation to try and head off another political disaster, quote unquote, from a forthcoming High Court decision. Again, Labor constantly trying to outflank the coalition to the right and, yeah, will happily punish refugees and migrants if they think it'll save their political skin.
Yeah, which I just don't even really think that there has been that much, like, the balance of the human and, you know, moral impact of that High Court decision in positive terms against any political or public blowback against Labor, surely the balance is positive. Like, are there really – I haven't seen – I think people have forgotten about it by now, except for the people who are no longer in fucking indefinite detention for, you know, seeking safety.
I mean, it was Labor policy to oppose indefinite detention, right? Now, it was often bullshit because they say people shouldn't be detained indefinitely and they say, okay, let's have a policy of limiting detention then, like the Greens. And they said, well, no, it's not that simple. We can't possibly do that. And so now you've got a High Court decision and it takes it off your shoulders completely. You get to say, this isn't our choice. This is the High Court, for fuck's sake.
Yes, this is a political get-out-of-jail-free card. Yes. And they're like, no, what's the catch?
No, hang on. Oh, no, we hate them too. Don't don't vote against us. Fuck them all. Anyway, we'll look into that more and explain to you exactly how cooked that is. But the Greens were speaking out about it. The coalition, I think, you know, also voted against it and referred to this committee too, whether they're just trying to get some political hay about it, I guess we'll never know. Although almost
what's
certainly
what's up
is.
With that? Like, why did they vote against it?
Well, they're part of the Noalition, Emerald, you see, in the
right.
In the
it's
coalition.
Part of the dirty deals. Dirty deals that they're doing with the Greens. I understand.
Australia's got a new power couple, Peter Dutton and Adam Baird. Speaking of other annoying commentary about the Greens this week, we also had Max on Q&A on Monday night for this housing special. I have not had a chance to watch it, and I really would like to. I think there will be interesting stuff in there. Cameron Murray was on there.
Do you think it might be too painful as a landlord?
Yeah, I think I'll be demonized.
Which one of your own get absolutely owned?
Well, thank God there was one woman there representing my interests and my thoughts. And she was sick of being demonized for owning property or properties in my case.
In our case.
Really good stuff. And then, love, solidarity to Max. People know how effective he is and how great he is and how he's cutting through because Labor are losing their mind and attacks are coming all over the place. There was a truly cooked opinion piece in Crikey about how Max isn't as good a left-wing populist as AOC or whatever. It was very strange. I'd love to have Max on at some point to sort of go through the latest on the housing debate and get his thoughts on all the how that debate is sort of rolled out. And I also genuinely don't know enough about planning laws, and I'm really interested to think what Max actually thinks about that issue and how it affects the housing crisis at the moment. I reckon Max is going to be a good one to have on to get into that thoroughly. Yeah.
You'd think so.
Oh, you'd think so.
Oh, yeah, you'd fucking hope so.
My heart's just pounding from the comments I've heard. Why do politicians feel that they need to keep taxing or changing the rules for how to claim our legitimate business expenses? Owning property is a business and takes time and effort to make sure all is running smoothly. I'm just so angry that as a landlord, I shouldn't have to feel guilty about owning property or properties in our case. Why does it appear that all landlords are demonised and put in the same bracket?
Max?
Look. Our political focus is on both major parties' failures to phase out those tax handouts for property investors. We have had a tax system that has encouraged people to buy up property investments and then able to write off any losses they make on that investment off on their tax. And look, I'm sorry, I just don't think that's fair. And the human consequences of a tax system and a rental system where a landlord can put up the rent by as much as they want at the end of every lease. Like, we desperately need caps on rent increases right now because the human consequences of that are the people I've spoken to. Single mums choosing between buying their baby's nappy rash cream or paying the rent. People living on the street,
sure,
families
but Max,
out of their... Well,
but isn't it the case that actually interest rates have risen as well, that some landlords actually are in significant financial trouble as well?
The worst consequences for that is selling an investment property and making a huge capital gains. I'm sorry, but I just think... can we just get real for a second here? 30% of this country rents, and right now, just like federal parliament, there's more Andrews than renters on this panel, and I think that really the voices of renters continually get silenced because the interests of landlords get put up against renters as if they are equal. But they are not, because if a renter loses their home, they're sleeping in their car on the street. If a property investor has to sell their home, that might be bad, but they still get a huge sale price out of that home. Okay. I think we just need a little bit of perspective.
Anne-Marie, I know your experience is very different to that. Who do you feel demonised by?
I feel demonised by the government because they want to take away capital gains tax.
The government hasn't proposed that.
Don't worry, it's only the Greens that want to do that.
Yeah, well, there you go.
I think Map of Tassie has to be one of my favourite Australian euphemisms, Australian slang. Your Map of Tassie. Show them your Map of Tassie.
I don't get it.
You don't get it?
I don't get jokes or vaginas.
I guess, right. So that is particularly a woman's pubic hair rather than a man's, because it doesn't really make that shape, does it?
Yeah, men's pubic hair doesn't have the V.
It's just a kind of, what is that? What state is that? I don't know. Western Australia. Victoria. It's just a kind of. Anyway, but we're not talking about that today. We're talking about the Tasmanian election We're late, but in some ways we're not, because they're still counting and we may not even know the final results for a long time, right?
Yeah, we did discuss it a little bit last week with Jack, with sort of the immediate results, when, of course, everything was very unclear because, yes, it's obviously a minority government, and so we sort of ran through some of the results. But, yes, as the counting continues, we have some more firmed up results. And looking pretty good for the Greenies.
Looking very good for the Greens. So it's looking like they need 18 seats to for a majority.
Yeah.
13 to the Liberals, 10 to Labor, at least 4 to the Greens. It seems like probably more. We're in with a chance in, I think, a further 3. At least a strong chance in 1 or 2 of those.
Including little Tabitha Badger's getting up, baby.
Your friend and mine, Tabitha Badger in Lions. That's doubled our representation because we had 2. Congratulations, Tassie Greens, the original and the best. Nah, Queensland Greens the best, but very impressive. 2 to the Jackie Lambie network, and possibly more, probably more even. 2 to the independents, and yeah, so 4 are still in doubt, but kind of yet to. That was the last time I checked the ABC website. This is on Friday that we're recording.
Do you see Tammy Tyrrell left the
Yes, I want to talk about that. Okay, cool. I want to talk about that.
Great.
Yeah. Anyway, I thought, like, so the Liberals, maybe this was already apparent when you discussed this last week, but like looks as though they will probably form government with probably the Lambie network and some independents, TBC. But they got a huge swing against them, like 12% swing against them. But that wasn't Labor picking up. That's not a swing, you know, the traditional like two-party system that hasn't gone to Labor. It's gone to Jackie Lambie network and the Greens effectively.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. What is it? Like 35% of the vote or something was going for non-major parties.
More than a third, it looks like, of people voted for minors and independents.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, that seems to be like a trend. It's interesting. Like it doesn't really seem, apart from the boost to the Greens, maybe that is a continuation of that trend in the Brisbane City Council election results. But like pretty much every election we've discussed recently, it's like people are turning away from the major parties, going towards minor parties and independents.
You love to see it.
You love to see it. And yet, yeah, like I can imagine. When did you record last week's episode?
We caught it on Sunday morning,
Sunday morning. So at that point, had Labor's Administrative Council or whatever they call them decided that they were just not going to negotiate at all, or was that still on the table?
That news broke literally hours. I mean, by the time the episode was put out, that news would have broken, I suppose. But before the recording, no, that was not clear. And we'd be like, oh, maybe Labor might have, I said to Jack Toohey, oh gosh, Labor might have to work with the Greens, which would be crazy because they said they'd never possibly do that.
Yeah.
And then, God damn it, if the Tasmanian Labor didn't give up quicker than I gave them credit for and said, fuck this noise, no Greens for us, we'd rather the Tories take power.
Yeah. So Rebecca White, Labor leader in Tasmania, well, not anymore, we'll get to that.
Yeah. 3-time loser now. Congratulations, Rebecca.
Congratulations, 3 times, yeah. On election night, she in her speech is being like, look, like quite a, you know, a very reasonable stance to take, I would say, that she's like, the people have voted. It looks as though, you know, we'll probably have to work with the crossbench, like definitely left it open. She said, quote, I thought it was very interesting, humble people don't speak of a coalition of chaos whenever they don't get their own way, or claim a victory when the results aren't clear, which I mean, that's so in contrast with like the position that, you know, Labor federally have taken and that Labor always take when they're like, no, we don't want to talk to the Greens. We don't want to negotiate with anyone. I think it's also
that
a dig
taken during the election campaign. Yeah, saying well, we will not work with the Greens.
Not to, right? Yeah.
Yes.
I think it's also that second part must be a dig at the Liberals because the leader, was it Jeremy Rockliff, stood up on election night. And even though they've got a 12% swing against them, was like, we've won, really triumphant, like very interesting framing to be like, everything's good here. People really like us. He's going, Tasmanians have not voted for a change of government, which I suppose may be strictly true, but it could have been untrue if Labor had simply chosen to negotiate with the crossbench.
Yes.
But anyway, yeah.
Extraordinary. Yes. Yep. So, I don't want to jump ahead, but I'm interested in this, in all the goss around that decision.
The goss.
Right?
So,
yes.
Rebecca White, okay, because so she takes that stance on Saturday night, and then Sunday morning comes out, well, not her, but the party, Tasmanian Labor, announces that they've lost. Their administrative committee has decided that they will not form government. There is no path to do that because they're not going to negotiate with anyone. And that
Do you reckon that someone in every Labor Party whose job it is to announce Labor losing?
Labor's like that's lost. Like a full-time office. A voted position. Yeah. Should be.
Like the highest paid position in the whole party. Be like, man, I run off my feet. We are losing all across the place at the moment.
Yeah. Really busy. Really busy. So, and then White formally concedes that afternoon. And I think, like, I don't know. She puts out a media release then where she goes, oh, actually, I have been clear that Labor will not do any deals with minor parties or independents. And this is what I think is very interesting. She says, we asked Tasmanians to vote for Labor if they wanted to change the government. So it's like they are literally willing to sacrifice. Do you think this is them sacrificing government now in order to make true their own attack line that if you vote for the Greens, you get the Liberals? Like that Labor cannot overturn a Liberal government if you vote Green?
I guess so.
Is that really?
I guess Labor's two competing hatreds, or their competing desire for power to be in government and their hatred for the Greens and the left come into conflict, and they chose to prioritise one over the other in an extraordinary move.
Yeah, I mean, I think like in terms of doing the right thing, it's absolutely fucked up and horrific that they would do this, particularly as it seems that the Liberals are now going to go into power with a far more conservative government. You know, they've got Erica Betts. It seems as though they had their kind of moderate, quote unquote, moderate Liberals, whatever that means, but resigned. And already Jeremy Rockliffe is saying, oh, we're going to look back at some of our policies and, you know, like allowing pets in rentals or regulating vacant, like we're going to go further right effectively. So yeah, to say like to hand government to the Liberals in that context is morally abhorrent, I would say. But yes. I almost do wonder if strategically giving themselves an example of where it is true that, you know, you voted Greens and you won more Greens and that could have meant that you changed the government from the Liberals, but it didn't happen. Maybe that is an effective example for Labor supporters to roll out next time they want to use that argument in an election.
God, how truly pathetic. I mean, again, I don't know enough about the history of Tasmanian politics and I couldn't tell you enough about the Lara Giddings premiership when there was a Labor-Greens coalition in recent memory. Certainly Tasmanian Labor seems to have despised that period, and that's the fueling period. Yes, but I mean, again, Tabitha, I think, mentioned briefly on our chat with her, it was a functioning government that got lots of stuff done and was, way better than the alternative, that's for sure. But yes, and so my understanding is that there was a bit of factional shenanigans going on within Tasmanian Labor, but is that just not really clear?
I don't know. I mean,
I also don't know what the administrative council is or what the fuck.
I assume it's their version of state council, right?
Right.
Surely. Yeah, okay. Or maybe it's their version of like management committee. Do you guys have management committee is that a Greens thing in every state? Probably. It could be either of those, I suppose. Like I know in the Queensland Greens after an election, if it's looking like we could have balance of power, there would be a state council, like an urgent state council meeting to make that decision.
Yeah.
It is interesting. A few people tweeted this, I think, the fact that, and maybe I wonder if this was introduced following the Greens-Labor accord in Tasmania, but in their rules, I guess, whether it's their bylaws or their constitution, it does say that the Parliamentary Labor Party and its members shall not enter into a power-sharing or coalition arrangement with any other political party where a member of that political party holds a ministerial or any other position within the cabinet. So basically they won't do a power-sharing arrangement where one of them gets the ministry. Further, then it says, if they find themselves in a position to form minority government, they shall not form minority state government unless the administrative committee has firstly been consulted. So that's where they've had that consultation and they've said no deal. But it's unclear to me. A few people are saying, well, Rebecca White went against that by leaving that possibility open in her speech and saying maybe we should. And then next minute, it looks like she's gone as leader. I just don't really know. Maybe I don't know enough about Tasmanian politics to know whether that's true. To me, it seems like their rules state that if they've lost, like after they lose the election, or even maybe it's after every election, they automatically spill the leadership position. Yes. I'm pretty sure that happens with the Greens as well. There's an automatic spill. The question is whether she will recontest again. I don't know whether she has confirmed or not. Seems like she was kind of being vague. Six News, our favourite news outlet, was reporting that she would likely not recontest due to a, quote, factional hit job from their sources. Nick right. McKim certainly had, Green Senator Nick McKim has views. He said, the faceless apparatchiks of Taz Labor have knifed Beck White because she extended a hand to the crossbench last night. They should explain to renters, to the homeless and the sick why they've so swiftly abandoned them to the ravages of Liberal government.
I mean, maybe
he's right. I think that's a bit dramatic. I don't know if that's what's happening. Maybe it is. What do you think?
Well, I don't really care about Rebecca White's leadership. I think it would be crazy if she continued as the leader because she's lost three elections, guys. Come on. I guess the pool is small, but fucking hell. Come on.
Yeah.
But I mean, again, even just based on these rules, it doesn't rule out the idea of going into a – like they didn't even wait for the results to see if they did have a decent chance of negotiating to get the numbers together. Potentially, you would go into those negotiations saying, we're not going to give you any ministerial positions.
Yeah, that's fine.
Here's what else we want to do. Okay, that's a starting point for negotiations. But it's just, no, it's the hatred and the idea that working with the Greens to get shit done is the worst thing in the entire world. And they would rather condemn the people of Tasmania to another 4 years of a Liberal, of a hopeless and, as you say, crueler and more conservative government then try and work with the Greens. It's a disgrace. Yeah.
Well, and this is the question that is going to repeatedly come up as we see the turn away from the major parties, and a lot of that is going to the Greens and to independents in some cases, alongside the current situation in federal parliament where the Greens are often holding the balance of power in the Senate. There's all of this discourse about whether Labor should or should not deal with the Greens, of course. There was this article that you were wanting to discuss we didn't get to last week or a couple of weeks ago by Sean Carney. That was an opinion piece titled, It's Monday After the Next Federal Election. Does Albanese Call Bant? Where he basically argued, like, no, he wouldn't and he shouldn't because CPRS and Gillard and because of the current situation where the Greens are, like, horse trading on legislation where they hold balance of power federally, which, of course, that's their mandate.
They will. Like, Tony Abbott called Adam Bandt in 2010. Tony Abbott called him.
Yeah, of course he's going to call him. Yeah.
Of course they're going to call.
But who knows? I mean, maybe Tasmanian Labor, maybe they're not. Maybe this is their new thing. They're like.
No one likes Tasmanian Labor. Everyone on election night, all the federal Labor people were like, Tasmanian Labor is truly fucked and stupid and dumb. This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
That was based on the results, really, and just how poorly they'd done. I don't know what the federal Labor position is on Tasmanian Labor abandoning government. You would have to think it's insane because even with a Greens coalition, which they already have in the ACT, remember, so that thing already exists, then you would have wall-to-wall every single state and territory in Labor hands. I cannot understand how that's not a good thing for the Labor Party.
Well, maybe this is the argument that they're like, they want to still have a Liberal government that they can blame somewhere for something. God. Who knows? There's a lot of stupid arguments in this Sean Carney article. It's kind of all over the place. I think, like, the arguments about, it was a terrible experience in the Gillard era. You know, he says most Australians were certainly uncomfortable 14 years ago after they elected a hung parliament.
What?
And Gillard negotiated with the Greens. I don't know where he gets that from. That's just vibes, I guess. He says that instantly doomed the government when she didn't, she broke her promise not to introduce the carbon tax. He also, he says, quote, Albanese was a senior minister back then and he'll have that history to draw on should he need to consider making a fateful call to ban in the not too distant future. And he even says, though, but he's like, yes, I suspect most voters would find a minority government difficult to accept. Yes,
what?
there's an irony here, given that the people get the parliament they have elected.
Oh,
but
yeah.
Our highly combative political culture is not conducive to governments made up of shifting multi-party alliances in the style of European and Scandinavian democracies. Why not?
There's no political conflict in Europe. I don't know if people know this, but everyone just gets along and they're just fine.
What is parliament for? Again, I just have to ask, what is with these people who are like, parliament is just too, I don't know, everyone's arguing all the time. Like, it's like, yes, this is parliament. That is literally what it is designed for, is for a contest. Like, it's a contest of debate. It's a contest of politics and ideas, whatever. Like, that, I think, is what parliament is designed for. I actually think these arguments are more stupid than the very kind of almost Machiavellian or whatever it is strategy of breathing their lies into existence, into truth, that you have to vote for Labor and not the Greens if you want to kick the Liberals out.
Isn't there a moment in there too where he's kind of like, well, I know they have it in the ACT, but I mean, the ACT is really just like a large local government. Like, what the fuck are you talking about?
I don't know. Yeah. I mean, sure, it's smaller, but I don't really know.
It's still, that's just such a pathetic way to dismiss the thing which completely undermines your entire
argument.
He just
wants to, he's like, I acknowledge that I'm wrong. However, I don't think so.
Also, at no point does he acknowledge the idea of Albanese having to go into coalition with the Green Zone would be the funniest possible outcome. Like, can't you at least acknowledge that would be entertaining?
Yeah,
and that the face, the look on Albanese's face every day when he has to acknowledge.
So grumpy. So grumpy. He would hate it. He would fucking hate it. I mean, I think surely what this shows as well, though, it is interesting. I kind of want to talk more about Jackie Lambie Network. And, you know, in places like in Queensland, for example, I think this about the Katters, that it does seem like it is a purely, it is a political positioning that they will not deal with the Greens because the Greens are a threat to them and they don't want to give any credence to the idea that the Greens could be a powerful political force or a force for good. And so I think they are more likely to deal with parties like the Jackie Lambie Network and the Katters or independents. Like, I think that's a more interesting question to me.
Well, Tasmania is very interesting because, of course, the biggest issue is the stadium and all those independents and Jackie Lambie and the Greens are all anti-stadium.
Well, no, apparently one of the Jackie Lambie Network candidates supports the stadium. This is the thing about the Jackie Lambie Network is they literally have no policies.
Yeah, no
policies. Like, that's what, apparently they proudly ran on that. There's a piece in Crikey, I can't even remember who wrote it, but yes, about the fact that they've campaigned on the idea that they do not have policies. They're just a bunch of good guys and gals that Jackie Lambie reckons are just quite all right.
Tops and Bonza.
You know, will do a good job. And so she comes out and she's like, yeah, I think the Liberals have done pretty trash, but I guess if my party wants to work with them on the basis of who knows fuck what priorities or policies or anything, go for it. Like, this idea that, the Jackie Lambie Network, I don't understand. Like, it seems as though, and this is why the resignation of Tammy Tyrrell, is it Tyrrell or Tyrrell?
Tyrrell, yeah.
Tyrrell. That's today or yesterday. She's resigned. That's a federal Jackie Lambie Network senator who has now resigned and says she's going to run as an independent in this very strange video where she's like, basically, Jackie doesn't think I'm doing a good job. I'm sorry, Jackie, I'm leaving. Even though I really like her still, we'll remain best of friends. We've had a loving partnership. Like, it's one of those like celebrity breakups where they're like, we love it. There's a lot of love there still.
Conscious uncoupling.
But we are conscious uncoupling. Yes, that's what the Jackie Lambie Network is doing. But she could have voted against her. Clearly. So why would she leave when clearly they have no policies? They have no, party structure. They have no reason to be a part. They're just a bunch of friends in parliament. I don't know.
I don't know what to. I did hear a few rumors about interpersonal clashes between Jackie and Tammy.
Like what?
Can I say this? I don't think I could actually specifically say this.
Oh.
It's all secondhand hearsay gossip about. I mean, look, I've interviewed Jackie Lambie, and when she's like having a bit of fun and she's done this on like commercial radio interviews, she will talk at length about how horny she is, how she doesn't get any action, and how she's desperate to find a man.
Okay.
So she can be quite forthright on that particular front. And I don't know, there was some kind
Tammy's
of
Tammy's a prude.
I don't know. Yeah.
She's a prude. Okay. We'll leave it there. That's fine. That's fine. But I do, yes, like Anthony Green was saying, Tammy Tyrrell's resignation is interesting because the negotiations in the new, like the Liberals' negotiations to form government in Tasmania may mean they could, quote, pick them off one by one. I don't really understand why her resignation means that. Like, is it just because he's saying maybe this indicates a split within the party that didn't exist before? I don't know if that's necessarily true. I think they've always kind of been free to do their own thing.
It's the chaos. Yeah. I mean, when basically the party is formed around a single personality who is Jackie Lambie, who is a a loose cannon who, as chaotic, we've said before, occasionally lands on a good position and can talk passionately from a working class perspective that's kind of admirable, but then can also throw in some red hot Islamophobia and chaos and will flip and change and has almost very poor negotiating skills and will fold very quickly under political pressure without holding up for something better. When that's sort of the basis of this very loose network of party, the same way the Palmer United thing fell apart and when Hansen is constantly going through turmoil, it's sort of chaos. But that would be interesting. If some members of the Jackie Lambie network supported this new Liberal government and others didn't, then that'd be a bit bonkers.
I mean, the whole, parties, whatever, like Jackie Lambie network. It's funny. It's like the Jackie Lambie network is like the Teals if they were honest. And, like, it's like they're less a party than the Teals are, but the Teals are pretending they're not a party. Mm. But anyway, but it's like this sort of, it's like a micro party pyramid scheme of some sort where they've gone from like Palmer defecting from the LNP and then Lambie defecting from Palmer United Party and then what's her name? Tammy defecting from Jackie Lambie Network. And I just have to, the Tasmanian election has shown again that, like, I'm sorry, but you are not special. And if you defect from a party like this to run as an independent, you will almost never win. Like those Liberals who defected from the Liberal Party in Tasmania to run as independents, everyone thinks that they're special. Everyone thinks they're the exception and that the electorate actually really loves them and not just, the party or the name that they recognize on the ballot paper. Mm. Like, babes, you will not win another term. But hey, I guess you've got your next 3 years, so maybe that's sweet.
Yeah, okay. Nick Xenophon too being wiped out as well.
Yep. Yeah.
All right, do you have time to talk about the GLP?
GLP, I mean, I guess, like the lessons from what Tasmanian Labor have done in this election are particularly interesting because it does seem like there is a split in the Labor Party between people who think it is inevitable we're going to have to work with the Greens and people who are like further and further in the other direction. Like, the better
I
the Greens do,
die.
Like they will sacrifice themselves on the stake of like, fuck the Greens. there was this, so this other article that we wanted to talk about, published by former Labor Majority Leader in Brisbane City Council, David Hinchliffe, also must be a Labor family because his, I think, brother is a Labor minister in the Queensland Parliament as well, Queensland Government. He
strong Labor family, like the Dicks.
Like the Dicks, big Dick and Little Dick, Milton and Cameron, that's right. David Hinchliffe, I guess, must have, like, so this must have been a situation, I didn't actually know this, that Campbell Newman held the mayoralty in Brisbane City Council, but there was a majority Labor council, I assume, and so he led that in this power-sharing arrangement with Campbell Newman. That would have been interesting, I'm sure. He does this op-ed in the wake of the Brisbane City Council election results titled, "Don't Gulp, the GLP, a combined Greens-Labor Party, is inevitable," where he argues that, his words, not mine, the Labor Party is in terminal decline. And, quote, "the only way I can see the Labor Party functioning in government is in partnership with and acting as a moderating influence on the Greens. I say that as a member of the ALP for 52 years. In 10 years' time, there will be a Green-Labor alliance. Both parties, especially Labor, will actively deny the possibility and probably denounce me, but the reality is it's inevitable."
Hey, David, I noticed you're typing away over there. What are you working on? Are you working on a piece to promote the Labor message and inspire the people to join the Labor Party?
Just you see.
Yeah,
just you wait.
How do you spell terminal decline?
I don't know. Maybe him and Sterling had a bust up at the whatever family dinner and he's like, "I'm going to write a fucking op-ed to fuck you over, you little bastard." Yeah. His analysis is a little confusing. So, like, it's interesting purely for that full other side of the Labor Party being like, no, this is where it's ending up. But he is simultaneously, his analysis is like, Labor is bleeding votes on the left to the Greens, like young people effectively, and bleeding, quote, working class votes to the Liberals, which questionable, that idea that, like poor people are all reactionaries and racist. Yeah. Not sure that that's necessarily true. I don't know what he means necessarily by working class. I mean, blue collar is the phrase that he uses. But the solution is
also just not true. Like, I mean, based on the polling, it's just like the working class vote is still overwhelmingly either Labor
yes.
or Greens.
Yes, I know. Yeah, no, but they just always like have that fear that that's what's happening is that anyway. And yeah. and he's
small
like,
business
yes.
owners, maybe, who go Liberals, but their workers not so much. Yeah.
He identifies, like he identifies this bleed on both sides, like this pull away from the center of effectively. If you say that the major parties are the center of politics, the bleed away from that. And his solution is more centrism. Like he says, there is an overwhelming need for a strong party of the center left. And his, I think what's interesting about his proposal is it's like a flip on what the Greens maybe have traditionally done, or particularly in the last few years when we're pitching for balance of power, is we will hold Labor to account. You know, during the federal election, we said we need to vote in more Greens to push a Labor government to go further and faster on X, Y, Z. Yes. He is like, we need Labor to keep a Greens, Jaggy Lambie Network, CATA, I don't know, government in line. Like, yes. That's the future that he sees. And I'm like, yeah, sure. You know, relegate Labor to a minority party. they can do their best.
It's this weird position where he's saying the Greens are coming up and they're building more power and Labor's slowly declining. But, you know, the Greens should really be more like Labor. Stop doing what you're doing, Greens, and be more like us, the people in terminal decline.
Yeah. I don't know if that's just him, like it's just his own cognitive dissonance, or it's like him trying to, I don't know, message to the Greens strategically. But yeah, he's like, it's quote, the Greens will never have a tangible effect on Australian policy without finding a foothold in the center. And to do that, they must moderate their more crazy extremists and find practical, pragmatic partners in the middle ground.
Like what? There are no policy examples here at all, are there?
No.
There's just no examples whatsoever.
No.
What is crazy extremists? Like not opening new fossil fuel projects?
Yeah.
Is that crazy?
That's right. I mean, yes, that's because, yes, if you look at the demands that the Greens have actually said that we would prioritise in a balance of power situation, what, dental into Medicare, crazy extreme. No new coal and gas, crazy extreme.
Taxing the rich.
Yeah, like regulating rent increases. It's all crazy and extreme, and that's why the Greens are growing their vote while Labor is in terminal decline, and that's why they should be friends. I don't know.
But he's doing this interesting jump, right? He's not talking about a Greens-Labor coalition in government. He's talking about the GLP, LNP.
Yeah, like the LNP in Queensland.
So they are like as if every election you'd be voting for the GLP. You would be voting in the same way that the Liberals and the Nats would negotiate who runs in each seat or whatever.
He's
and
just
so
trying
people
to-
would be voting
jump on
for
our
them
rising star.
Coalition. Yeah, so that's
like,
that's
just you'll only hold us back.
That's actually correct. Like I haven't even thought about that. I think we've got a long way to go before we get, and then it'd actually probably be a sign that something weird's going on in the Greens, to be honest, if we signed up to a deal like that. Because what would that mean to the Greens and Labor? Like, are we changing the democratic processes within each parties, and how do we work together? And like, opens up a whole kettle of fish.
It really does.
Let's just have a few more coalition governments first, I think, and then we'll warm up to that.
Teach the people a lesson and we'll come back to it.
They're always saying they're only targeting Hamas and everybody else is a casualty. Well, if those guys are just unarmed civilians and they're walking alone, that's what they appear to be.
Dresden.
And you just blast them from the sky with robots.
This is the tragedy of war.
Yeah, this is insane. And no one knows what to think now, because if you can't talk about that, if you can't say that's real, then you're saying that genocide is okay as long as we're doing it. And
that is what we're saying.
And if you're saying that from a perspective of someone who literally went through the Holocaust.
All right, Israel's ongoing genocidal war in Gaza continues, as does the humanitarian crisis it is causing. We're entering the sixth month of this conflict now. Obviously, the crisis has been going on a lot longer than that, but this particular conflict is now 6 months old, and there's been a lot of news coming out of it, almost all of it pretty horrible. A few weeks ago, you might remember some stories about Australia cancelling the visas of Palestinians who were coming here on certain tourist visas in an absolute shit show. We didn't have a chance to really discuss that in depth on the show, and we wanted to, and find out more about the situation for Palestinians who are here in Australia, what Australia is and isn't doing for people in that situation, and how we can help if possible. And so we are delighted to be joined by Reem Borrows, who is a board director for an organization called the Palestine Australia Relief and Action Foundation, aka PARA. Hello, Reem. Thanks so much for being on Serious Danger.
Oh, thanks so much for having me here.
Of course. Maybe just briefly, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and about what PARA does and your relationship to PARA and all that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I am a very proud Australian, a very proud Palestinian. I came out to Australia when I was 14. So my family immigrated directly from Haifa in the 48 territories. And so for me, all my grandparents were born in Palestine. I was born in the same area as what my grandparents were born in. But by the time I was born, I was no longer allowed to actually identify myself as Palestinian. Mm. So I became classified as an Arab Israeli within the 48 borders. Once we came to Australia, my whole family did immigrate, like my immediate family immigrated to Australia. We're talking about 40 some years ago. It was a real eye-opener for us because when we walked through the Sydney airport, there was the customs officer who was originally from England. He said, you know, welcome to Australia. Where are you from? And my dad proudly stood up and he said, I'm Palestinian. And he, the customs officer at the time, put a big smile on his face. He goes, I know your plight only too well. Welcome to Australia.
Aww.
And it's a beautiful story to be able to tell because ultimately I will never forget that moment. That's what true freedom felt like, that we were able to identify ourselves at the very minimum.
Yeah.
Mm. Truly. So my work in Australia, we, like as any immigrants and very proud Australians, we actually got our citizenship within 3 years of being here in Australia. Mm-hmm. And swore our allegiance and we travelled, we worked in Darwin. My parents worked in Darwin. I went to high school in Darwin for 5 years. We've lived in Brisbane, lived in Melbourne, lived in Sydney. So we call Australia home. But there's always a part of us that understands what the plight of Palestinians and yearning to be free back in the old country. Mm. And a lot of that has come now to sort of face us all globally.
Yeah.
And so now it's kind of like in the diaspora, what is our responsibility? Because we do know what freedom is like and because we do know what the situation is like in the old country, what is our responsibility in the diaspora? And I don't pronounce it very well, but you can pronounce it for me. Okay.
I think it's either way, isn't it?
Diaspora. Tomato.
Exactly. Yeah. But we have a real responsibility because what we're seeing right now is a humanitarian crisis. Now, in the last, as you said, in the last 6 months, it really has escalated to the point of pure darkness. Mm. Now, this is when it comes to modern day darkness, we've not seen anything like this. Mm. And so PARA was formed, and it is formed by Australian Palestinians who just want to be able to help. But the fundamental mission is to center, strengthen, and amplify Palestinian voices.
Mm.
We want to be able to help people to come to Australia, migrants and refugees, to live safe, happy and fulfilling lives in Australia, just as we had the opportunity to.
That's a pretty good mission. We're on board that.
It really is. And every other immigrant that came to Australia, unless you're Indigenous to the country, we're all immigrants. Mm-hmm. How long you've been here, whether it's 2 generations, 5 generations, 1 second, is almost irrelevant, really. But we need to be able to afford everyone the same rights once they hit our lands as well.
Mm-hmm.
We'd love to talk about this story that sort of blew up in March, earlier in this month. Australia has been granting a lot of visas. I think the latest count's like 2,200 visas to Palestinians and 2,400 to Israelis since October 7th, which is kind of bizarre that we've given more visas to Israelis than Palestinians. But anyway, you know, visas are good, particularly if people are trying to, you know, fleeing the horrific onslaught that's being waged on Gaza. Most of them have been temporary visas giving similar rights to tourists in Australia. Okay, and we'll come to why that's not ideal in a moment, perhaps. But early in March, there were these stories coming out about people getting a tourist visa, waiting for ages to get those tourist visas, being on their way to Australia and having that cancelled. This is from the ABC. One Australian woman applied for temporary visas for her 2 sisters and nieces, which were approved in November of last year. Like many other Palestinians trying to get out of Gaza, they were unable to leave for months as they waited to get the green light from border officials. That's the control that you mentioned there, Reem. Yeah. After successfully making it out of Rafah, one sister had her Australian visa cancelled in Cairo, while the other sister and her 4 children were able to go to a transit country. Right before their flight to Australia, the mother was told at the airport that her visa had been cancelled, but her children would be able to board the plane. Like, truly insane that they would imagine a woman would just, you know, pop her kids on the plane there. I mean, obviously, some parents are forced into that situation when fleeing persecution, but pretty wild. Her cancelled notification, which has been obtained by the ABC, stated that she had never intended a genuine stay temporarily in Australia. So we had a few of these cases coming out that Australia was cancelling the visas of Palestinians who were coming to Australia, which people were like, what the hell is going on here? Can you give us a bit of background exactly what happened there? Have we got a satisfactory explanation as to what happened? Why were these visas pulled at the last minute?
Yeah, look, it's, again, another very good question. It came as a surprise. We definitely weren't expecting it. It was very, very difficult to for people to get out of Gaza in the first place. And once they were out, our expectation was we helped them get on the flight from Egypt or wherever they are. Some people went through Istanbul. So, you know, from Egypt to Istanbul, some people went from Egypt to Abu Dhabi. Some people went from Egypt to China, to Australia. Mm. And again, it depends on what flights are available. What we didn't expect is that for people to reach Egypt and for their visas to be cancelled en route, either in Egypt or when they're on a flight going to the second destination and they get off the flight to get into from Abu Dhabi to, for example, to Australia, and for them to be told that it's been cancelled en route, which is madness. I mean, you think about it for yourselves even. Even if you are going to a destination, let alone being just been through a genocide and the horrific events in Gaza, and then you reach a foreign country and then they say to you, oh, sorry, your visa's been cancelled. Now, to add to the complication of it is Palestinians do not have representation in any country they go to simply because of the occupation. We are an occupied people and had been occupied since 1948. And I know some people go 67, but it really all started in 1948. Uh-huh. And it just slowly started to disintegrate. Uh-huh.
No embassy, no officials,
no representation,
to talk to.
No legal rights. No, I mean, they're coming out of a genocide. And to top all of that, they have a narrative, a false narrative that's been circulated through mainstream media. So they've got no money. They literally got the shirts that they're wearing and they're coming to Australia in the hope just to start a new life or to get themselves out of danger.
Yeah.
Quite scary. Imagine if it was you or I.
It was, yes. I mean, thank God it got some coverage and people were sort of saying, this is a disgrace. What the hell's going on here? And a couple of days later, that decision was reversed. I mean, again, do we have a satisfactory, do we have any kind of explanation as to why that happened? Or
Look, we could go into a whole host of different like conspiracy theories here. And I, you know, sometimes there's always truth to those conspiracy theories, as you know. But the thing is, we went into very, very quickly work with our international lawyers plus the government to try and rectify it. Genuinely, the government in the government bodies that we were working with and the individuals that we were working with were surprised. So I can honestly say that they were surprised. It didn't catch them off guard. They didn't know why it was happening. Was it a teething problem? Was it a glitch in the system? Was it someone who didn't understand what they were meant to be doing and took it upon their own themselves to cancel the visas? We don't really know. What we are saying is that basically we're very grateful that it was rectified, and we do know that a lot of members in the government bodies that we worked with were genuinely surprised.
Did this have to do any of the Israeli visas that any issues with the Israelis?
That's an interesting thing because it was very, very random, incredibly random. Like if you have four people and one gets cancelled, why? If you have 13 people and then the father's gets cancelled, why is that en route again? And we know that, you know, some people are going, oh, it's because of security reasons. I'm going to bring it all up. We're very transparent by the way that we, you know, want to have a conversation with people. Well, in terms of security reasons, when people apply for these visas, they are vetted so carefully. Let's not kid ourselves. People in Gaza have no privacy. Israel controls everything in Gaza, including the births and deaths register. They know everything. No one leaves Gaza without being screened. Nothing enters or leaves Gaza that doesn't have scrutiny. So let's start again, let's not kid ourselves here. So then you have to really question what's going on here and what narrative are we choosing to believe around humanity around what a Palestinian is and is not.
We
really need to question that, because you're right. Were Israelis screened the way that Palestinians are screened?
Probably not. I mean, this, the idea that these visas were rushed. Has any visa in the world ever been rushed in history, particularly an Australian visa? The only visas that seem to be rushed are the visas for rich people who have connections to the government. Yes, the au pairs who quickly need to get in.
Yeah, absolutely. And these visas, the reason why they made them into tourist visas was because they said it was just easier to get people here. It was the easiest way to get people here quickly.
Okay.
I mean, to get the response around, well, you have no, you know, you don't have any. What were the words that you read out? It was
an intention to stay temporarily. Intention to stay. Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, it's a genocide.
Yes. Jesus.
It's a graveyard.
Yeah.
And I'll give you my experience with refugees. No one wants to leave their country unless they're forced to.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So they say you can only come here if we're pretending that you're coming here for a holiday, effectively.
For a holiday.
And then they're like, I'm starting to think you're not just coming for a holiday.
Absolutely. Hang on. Absolutely. And those visas that had been issued in Australia are only people that were only allowed those visas if they have Australian citizens as family members, immediate family members in Australia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
Yeah.
So this is not random.
Good Lord. Yes. Well, and then so for the people who are lucky, who haven't had their visas cancelled, and again, those ones that were cancelled were pretty much restored, which is, again, good news and a good example of the media coverage sort of leading to some kind of blowback and getting results, which is good. But the folks who are here, and there was a good read in The Guardian about this, are on this subclass 600 visa, which means they basically have no work rights, right? So they're tourist visas, they can't work, they don't have access to healthcare or any kind of part of the Australian welfare state. And they, if they want to apply for more, they have to wait 12 months for a bridging visa. And during that time, they're basically entitled to nothing, right? And The Guardian is talking to folks who are like, I don't know how I'm going to feed my kids. I'm here. I've just escaped a genocide. I'm not technically here on a humanitarian or refugee visa, but that's clearly what I am, because I'm escaping, you know, the devastation of my homeland. And these people are in a pretty dire situation. And that's the kind of work that PARA does, right? Supporting those folks who have come from Palestine who are trying to survive while they're here, right? Yeah. Well, I mean, what do they need? What would be a better system? What is PARA calling for? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Like one of the things, so we'll talk a little bit about the light right now, because there's a lot of darkness. But one of the things that we have seen from Australian and the community here in Australia is the absolute open heart that we've seen of people wanting to support those less fortunate who are coming from a genocide. There is a real recognition that they have been through the toughest times that, again, we've seen in modern time. What we're hoping for, I mean, these people are coming to Australia. All they want to do is go back to, this is what a Palestinian wants, by the way. People will often go, well, what does a Palestinian want? They want to be able to feed their family, house them. They want to be able to teach their children. They want to go get an education. Most of the people that we're seeing coming here, they're saying, well, how can we work? We want to go back to uni. Because as you know, I don't know if you know this, but the Palestinians are some of the most educated in terms of university degrees in the world. We have per capita, we have one of the highest rates of university education. It's very sacred to us, the sanctity of education. But they can't right now unless they are, you know, international students, marked as, but who has that kind? They've just left everything and lost everything. They don't have a single cent to their name.
Yeah.
So they've come here. There's no settlement provisions. Unlike many other refugees that have been taken in by Australia, Palestinian refugees have no settlement provisions. So we're relying on the generosity of the community for donations. And everyone that's working with PARA and a lot of other organisations, by the way, and a lot of individuals as well, who we're really coming together to help them settle here in Australia as easily as possible with the dignity and respect that they deserve. This is another thing. Like for whatever reason, we I think you mentioned it earlier on, Tom, you know, if you wanted to rush a visa or do something really, it needs money. Right, and we treat people who are less, more fortunate than us better than people who are less fortunate than us. And yet those people who have got the most to lose and those people who are in the most like extraordinary hardships, we're not treating with the dignity and respect that they deserve.
Yeah.
And the contrast, I suppose, is the way that some other folks are being treated, some other different people from different countries who are, you know, absolutely just as deserving, who are facing a terrible time. I'm thinking specifically of Ukrainian refugees that Australia very uncontroversially opened its arms to. I mean, the first 5 months of Russia's war in Ukraine, 11,500 Ukrainian arrivals to Australia had access to a three-year humanitarian visa granting Medicare, work and study rights. Okay, Albanese government ended that scheme in July of 22, but I mean, we've seen this. When a certain crisis comes up, certain visas are created, special humanitarian categories are created in response to that crisis.
Yeah.
That is not happening, despite the fact that we have, what, more than 31,000 civilians killed, the International Court of Justice saying there is a potential genocide here. Everyone knows it, that really what it is, a genocidal war. But it seems to me, because that genocide is being carried out by one of our supposed allies and because our government is complicit in carrying that genocide out, then when it comes to humanitarian protection, it seems to be a completely different kettle of fish. Is that fair to say?
No, absolutely. And look, all we're asking for at PARA is that we treat everyone equally. So some of the questions that need to be asked is, number one, you know, if it was 11,500 visas, attributed to Ukraine refugees. Mm. Why is the Palestinian visa now count at 2,000?
Mm.
Okay, we're talking about horrific situations here.
Mm.
Again, they are in a situation where they cannot protect themselves. It's so hard to get out of Gaza in the first place. Should we not be opening up our hearts? Second question that we really need to ask ourselves, even if we are allies, right? Like, doesn't matter. Let's just put politics aside. Where is the humanitarian efforts here? And why do we keep differentiating between one human life and another?
Mm-hmm.
How is it that a Palestinian life does not equal any other, like, for example, an Israeli life, a Ukrainian life? How is it? And what's driving this?
Mm.
What false narratives are we still wanting to believe and really believing? And what is our responsibility as Australians?
Mm.
Very good questions. And an answer to that is, well, horrible racism stuff. And our responsibility is to help out wonderful organizations like PARA. We will put the link in the show notes, para.org.au. Your donations to help Palestinian migrants and refugees seek safety in Australia and achieve their full potential. This is from the website. Free from the barriers created by conflict and displacement. And so the kind of things that your tax-deductible donation can help support flights to Australia, accommodation, immediate health and well-being care, visa and legal advice when it's not available, pro bono, and the living costs of just being a human being and feeding your kids and rent and clothes and all those kind of essential goods and services. So that's this week's call to action. And we're asking if you're in a position in which you can chip in or help out, go to para.org.au and support this fantastic work that you're doing. It's been a pleasure to talk to you, Reem. Thanks for giving us your time. We really appreciate it.
Look, thank you so much for your time, and I really appreciate it too. And, you know, we are celebrating also Good Friday. It's not just and Ramadan at the same time. And this is a time to call out, to say, let's just remember what the purpose behind and what the meaning behind Good Friday is.
Mm.
And it is about opening up our hearts and treating everyone equally.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for your time. We appreciate it.
Thanks, Reem. Feel like this anymore, can't feel like this anymore, can't feel like this, can't feel like this, can't feel like this anymore. Please rate and review the show on Apple Podcasts or wherever you're listening now. I'm literally begging you, please do it. It's really nice. Other ways that you can support the show include: become a patron, $3 a month, get bonus content, it's all good shit. Follow us on social media while they're still letting us speak at SeriousDangerAU on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. I think we probably need your help more than ever. Just like comment love hearts or whatever you want, really just nice things. Please help us with the algorithm. You can find links to all of that plus the shows that are still on sale. Please come see us live at SeriousDangerPod.com. Next weekend, the main episode for the week will be the live show from Melbourne. Should be out at the same time. There will probably be some special bonus stuff on there that will be for patrons only, and stuff that maybe will be just for the live show folks. But there will be an episode coming out as usual. As always, you can get in touch with us at hello@seriousdangerpod.com. Did I forget anything?
don't think so. We love you, everyone. So. Hey, Happy give it up Easter. For Jesus, everyone. Yeah, thanks, Jesus.
Wow, good on him. So good.
Shout-outs to a real one.
Yeah, shout-out Jesus.
This is a serious danger to Australia.